I wonder if you can articulate a little bit for our viewers why it matters how many women are employed in the UN's professional service, and particularly in its leadership.
You know, Peg,
how does it matter outside the UN?
You know, Peggy, this matters a lot. It is important to understand how different women leaders in the UN have brought transformation in the system through their understanding of the grounded realities of women's lives and what needed to change, and their relationship with women's civil society, what I call the inside-outside relationships. Now, by its nature, the United Nations is a hierarchical intergovernmental organization where mainly male government leaders make decisions that affect the directions and functioning of the organization. But at the same time, the United Nations has a very strong history of mobilization and partnership based on the values and the moral authority of the UN Charter. Now, it has opened new possibilities, created spaces and built alliances with we the peoples to bring about social change and accountability, especially with women and civil society. Now, the success of women leaders in the system was actually knowing how to reclaim the convening power and the authority of the UN to mobilize the power of constituencies, and knowing how to use top-down and bottom-up leadership to change the rules of the game when they did not work for women. Now, in short, women leaders in the UN have engaged civil society and governments and have the experience of cooperating to build an inclusive multilateralism from the ground up, mobilizing to establish new agendas, but also new practices based on the UN Charter as we the peoples imagine the worlds anew. Now, let me just give you a few very concrete examples of the people whom I know and I've worked with. Helvi Sapela from Finland. Now, she was the first woman, and I'm sure you know her, Peggy, who hold the position of the UN Assistant Secretary General in 1972. Now, she used her position to organize the first ever World Conference on Women in 1975. When she was the Secretary General, and this opened up new spaces for dialogue with women everywhere. Now, Nafis Sadiq, a dear friend from Pakistan, a wonderful leader whom I admire, was appointed in 1987 as the first woman from the developing world to head an operational fund of the UN as the Executive Director of UNFPA. This was the Population Fund. She was instrumental in addressing the reproductive health and needs of women on the ground and incorporating their voices into population policies and programs internationally. When she became the Secretary General of the International Conference on Population and Development, commonly called the ICPD, she brought a whole new perspective and narrative to population and development issues. Now, both their work fed into the Fourth World Conference on Women and the Beijing Platform for Action, seen as the landmark global action plan for women's empowerment till today as we celebrate Beijing Plus 25. Now, it is important, however, not just to have women leaders in the UN system itself, but also to have women as diplomatic representatives of their member states. For example, several women ambassadors were so inspired by UNIFEM's global video conference highlighting the concrete work of the UN Trust Fund to End Violence Against Women that I started in UNIFEM, that they immediately took leadership in the 1999 UN General Assembly to establish the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. So on 17 December 1999, the General Assembly unanimously agreed that the 25th of November will be the International Day to End Violence Against Women. And every year, women worldwide use the 25th of November till Human Rights Day on the 10th of December to organize for greater efforts to end violence against women. Now, another example is in the area of peace and security. Navi Pillay from South Africa made a big difference, Peggy, when she was a UN-appointed judge and president of the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. Now, Navi understood the criminal and the politicized nature of rape in the Rwandan genocide and upheld the need for accountability. With women's organization, we work together to address sexual violence against women as a weapon of genocide. Her judgment in 1998 was historic, as it set precedents not only for the Rwanda tribunal, but for rape and sexual violence to be prosecuted under international law as an act of genocide. Now, maybe I could even share about my role as executive director of UNIFEM. And one of my proudest achievements was working with the Security Council and women from conflict-affected countries on the Women, Peace and Security agenda that resulted in Security Council Resolution 1325 in 2000. Now, this marked the beginning of the Women, Peace and Security agenda in the Security Council, thanks to Namibia using its presidency in such a strategic manner. Now, Security Council 1325 consists of four pillars: prevention, protection, participation, peace building, and recovery. Now, it was a major mindset change and a new paradigm for peace and security, because it broke the silos for the first time between human rights, development, peace and security, and addressed sexual violence as a war crime and promoted women's rights to inheritance, health, education, and employment as critical for sustaining peace and in rebuilding of society. Basically, it shifted the idea of security as military security to human security. It supported women's meaningful participation in peace and recovery to overturn underlying inequalities and to shift to a future that upholds justice, restores confidence, and transforms institutions for greater peace and security. And this year, we are indeed celebrating the 20th anniversary of this resolution. In short, many women leaders in the UN have brought changes to policies and actions that people thought were impossible or far too radical.